This video is by request from Steve Goring, and I apologize if I got your last name wrong, Steve. But Steve is working on a project that involves a pair of dice. He's working over a black background. He wants the dice to be white, and he sent me a picture of a rough layout that he's thinking about using. It looks like this. If I understood correctly, Steve is struggling with two things. The first is how to go about rendering the dice with his airbrush. And the second is he mentioned he wants to add the illusion of movement when he actually paints them. So if we go back to the photograph of his rough layout, what jumps out to me is the fact that both of these dice are oriented exactly the same. That orientation is very stale. It has good dimension, but it looks like those dice are sitting still. I've said it before and I'll say it again. Improving your drawing skills will not only help you improve your painting skills, but it also helps you develop your creative skills. And this is a prime example of something we can all practice on that is not overly complicated. I'm not going to say it's easy, but it's not super complicated. We're dealing with two squares. So let's take a look at some ways that we can really make this pop and add some movement into this piece. I sat down for a few minutes off camera and sketched out how I would approach trying to accomplish the same things that Steve is trying to accomplish in his piece. And this is what I came up with. The first thing I changed is the orientation of the dice. They no longer look exactly the same. And I recognize that they didn't look exactly the same if you take into account the numbers on the dice, even in Steve's example. I'm talking about the orientation of the cube itself. Now we have a different orientation between both of these dice. The one on the right looks like it could probably be sitting on a table. The one on the left is angled upward just a little bit more, which gives that illusion that maybe it's still moving after the dice has just been thrown. The other way we can add the illusion of movement into a piece like this is to play with the perspective. The perspective on the right side is probably closer to accurate. This was all done by eye. I didn't measure any of this to make sure it was accurate. The perspective on the left side is not even close to accurate. If you really look at it, you'll see that I exaggerated the perspective of this cube. Is that accurate as far as realism is concerned? No, but it helps to sell the idea that the dice are actually moving. They're not just sitting still. That's artistic license. Your creative ability, you can do with this whatever you want. It doesn't have to be just like it would be if it was actually real. You have the ability to change things, and it's not a drastic change. The perspective in this is exaggerated, yes, but it's done subtly. If you look closely, you'll see that I even exaggerated the perspective in the numbers themselves. The two holes on this side are smaller than the two holes on this side. The three holes on this one progressively get slightly smaller. This is literally something that you can practice for 5 to 10 minutes and come up with your own idea. It's good practice. You can orient the dice in any number of ways. You're really only limited by your own imagination. It's cheap. It's a pencil and a piece of paper. It's very easy to change when you mess up. I erased several sections while I was sketching this one out. The other thing I really like about this is it's very easy to throw some shading into your sketch and play with different light sources. And that doesn't take long either. All I was doing was scribbling with the pencil and then wiping it with my finger. One other detail I'd like to point out is a pair of dice usually has rounded corners on it. They're not a sharp point. And I like to incorporate that as just a touch of detail and more realism when I'm rendering dice. So now we have a good design concept. The only thing I didn't mention previously that also helps to portray the illusion of that movement are those little wispy lines you probably noticed behind the dice in the sketch. We'll cover that more in the actual painting portion of this video. So now we need to look at how we are going to transfer the design onto our project. There's a number of different ways that you could transfer this onto whatever it is you're working on. I've just got a black panel. I've covered a lot of those ways on the channel. This time I'm going to use some transfer paper or transfer tape. To cover the panel. My knife. Make sure that's burnished down fairly well. And then I can take some Sorel paper, a couple pieces of tape, lay the Sorel paper on top of our transfer tape with the graphite side down, tape that into place. And I made a photocopy of the sketch use to trace this onto the panel, and I'm just going to kind of feel the edges of the panel to roughly get this somewhat centered, and then I will tape my sketch into place, and then I can take a ballpoint pen and trace this out. Doesn't need to be perfect. And if you're wondering if you've got everything or not, you can always lift this up and take a look at what you've traced. So now I can remove the photocopy and the Sorel paper. And we have a decent enough image to use to begin cutting this out. So most of the time, I prefer to use a number 11 X-Acto blade to cut out whatever it is I'm painting. You can also use a razor blade, whatever is more comfortable for you. The one thing that you should do is make sure you have a brand new sharp razor blade or X-Acto blade, whatever it is you're using, to cut out your mask. This transfer tape is relatively thin. It takes very little pressure to cut through it. You do not want to cut into the surface that you're actually painting. So be very careful with that. It takes some practice, but it's not difficult to be able to cut through this material without cutting into the surface that you're going to be painting. So let's cut this out. A lot of times, if you can't remember exactly where you're cutting ends. If you rub the blade on the mask, you'll be able to feel it. I say that and I actually can't feel where my previous cut was. Take your time. I want these lines to be as straight as possible. Very difficult to cut out a really nice circle and a really nice oval with a blade. Do the best you can. We can use a stencil later to kind of clean those up if we need to. I went ahead and cut the other side out off camera just to speed the process up a little bit. So from this point, we're ready to start applying paint. First thing we need to do is remove a portion of our mask. I'm going to remove the corners on both of these first, and you can use your X-Acto blade or your razor blade to do this. I prefer to use these little plastic razor blades because you don't have to worry about poking into the surface underneath and damaging the paint. You might find an area where you didn't quite get it cut completely. You can bring the blade back in if you need to. Carefully removing this, I'm trying not to rip it. My corners weren't cut super clean. That should work. The other thing important here is I'm going to save what I remove. I don't intend to use these again, but in the event that we need them, it's always a good idea to save the portions of the mask that you remove. Get this other side. I'm just stabbing at a corner where I've cut in order to lift a portion of this, and then the rest of it is moved relatively easily just by pulling it up. So with those two portions of our stencil removed, we can actually begin painting. I'm using Createx Illustration Neutral Gray number 9. This is the lightest shade of gray in the Neutral Gray series. It's reduced about 2 to 1, maybe 1.5 to 1. So 1.5 or 2 parts paint to 1 part 4011 reducer. I'm using my Iwata HPCS Eclipse, and my air pressure is set at about 30 psi. So I'm going to begin by painting the corners of these dice. And I want to focus the highlight more on this corner that's closer to the viewer. So the idea here is similar to what we did in the Starburst video. I'm going to allow the overspray to work to my advantage. So I'm going to concentrate the spray to begin with in the corners, working lightly, really building up the highlight on that corner. I I'm going to start letting the overspray drift along the edge. Keeping this corner the brightest or most intense area. For the back sides, I want to fade a little bit of color in there just to separate that from the background. Maybe just a hair bit brighter on that one. That should be good. So if you're wondering why we didn't fill the areas that we have currently unmasked in completely with paint, it's because we're actually using the background, the base coat black, to assist us in shading these dice. So at this point, we're ready to go ahead and remove another section of the mask. I think I'm gonna go with the top of these dice. Peeling slowly around our number markers to make sure those are cut all the way around. Once again, I'm going to save this above the panel. It's also a good idea to make sure your paint is dry before you start poking at it with a plastic razor blade or a real razor blade. And now we'll repeat the same process, applying paint to the new unmasked area. Now it's important to pay attention to your light source, which we've somewhat established a light source coming from in front of these dice by adding a brighter highlight on this corner. So I'm going to begin filling in with some paint, and I want at least a light area or light layer of paint all the way across, just to differentiate the top of this die from the background. Same thing on the other side. Now we can begin building up the actual highlight and the shadowed area. We'll be right back. can add a few streaks if you'd like. Now it's a repeat of what we just did. We'll remove the next section that we want to paint, which I think I'll use the right sides. And we'll follow this by, again, adding some more paint. A light wash to begin with. And then we can begin building up the highlighted portion. Leaving this corner just a little bit darker to differentiate between that corner with the highlight and then the other side of the die. And at this point, we can go ahead and remove the last side of the mask. good idea when you're working with hand cut masks, kind of brush the surface with your finger. Make sure you don't have any little slivers of your mask left behind. And then we'll add some of our gray to this last side of our dice. Making sure it's dry. I'm pretty happy with what we have up to this point. You probably noticed while I was spraying the sides of our dice, I was using more streak motions with the airbrush rather than just a uniform, even coverage. And that's just to give it a little bit more interest to make it look like maybe it has some reflective properties. When you're using a hand cut paint mask like this, especially at a smaller scale, chances are this is not going to be perfect. So now would be a good time to go in and clean up some areas that maybe you're not really happy with. There's one that I see right here. So my cut right here, if this shows up on camera, was not exactly straight. It's slightly jagged in this corner, right to the left of this corner. So to address that, I come in with a freehand shield, line that up about where I want it, and then we can try to fill that in. Spraying more on the shield than I am on the panel. That looks better. So now I think we'll go ahead and remove the masks on all of our dots. These are not going to be perfect either because they were hand cut. as I suspected, my hand-cut dots or ovals are far from perfect, and that's to be expected with a hand-cut mask. I'm going to address the issue using two freehand shields. This is the FH6. They have a large one and a smaller one, and in the center of these two stencils are three little oval cutouts. That's what I'm going to use in order to clean these up. There are a number of different ways you could do this depending on the size of your project. This is what I'm going to use in this case because this is roughly the size that I need for the ovals on these dice. I may lose some of my perspective changes as far as how they're sized differently. That's okay, I can live with that. So I've switched to black in the airbrush. I'm just going to line this up as best I can. And lightly go over these dots. Make sure it's dry before you remove the mask. That looks better already. There is one little spot on this side that kind of bows out. I'm okay with that. In this case, it's not ideal, but that looks better now than it did just a moment ago already. Same thing, we'll go over to this one, which is going to make it larger. That's okay. Using very light layers. Make sure that's dry. And I got a little bit of overspray right there. So we should probably put some tape over that one. We'll fix that here in a few minutes. For now, let's see about continuing to fix these ovals. Better when they were getting larger and smaller, but sometimes you gotta make sacrifices when you're dealing with a hand-cut mask. So that was poor planning on my part. I should have foreseen that issue, meaning the fact that my hand-cut ovals were not going to look all that clean to begin with, and then having a plan beforehand in order to fix it. These shields did work great for cleaning those up. They look much better. I still like the dots getting smaller as far as the perspective is concerned on my rendering compared to the actual painting. This top one I was actually able to make a little bit smaller using the smaller FH5 shield. I could have done the same on that one, but I didn't at the end of the day. This is just a demo panel for this particular video. From this point, I still have black in the airbrush. You can come in and add just a little bit of reinforcing shadows on these. Just a hint, remember less is more, to really show the three-dimensional properties of this painting. So for this one, I'm going to come in and just freehand very lightly. Do the same thing on the other side. When you are getting into that really bright area, you can use your freehand shield. To shield that area. The other thing I think I might want to do is just a hint of shadow in the corner. To do that, I'm going to use both freehand shields. To protect our highlight. Just dust. Little bit of color in that corner. I know that corner was rounded before we just did that. That's okay. We will address that here in a few minutes. Do the same thing on the other side. Dusting some color in that corner. Maybe a streak or two on the top. I forgot to mention which black I was actually using. That was Autoborne Sealer Black. The only reason I was using the Autoborne Sealer Black versus a black Createx paint is because that's what I had mixed up and sprayed the background of this panel with. The streaks are completely optional. That's up to you. I thought it would add some more interest. At this point, I'm undecided whether I really like it or not. We'll see when it's finished, but you can leave it shaded just like it was with only the neutral gray, or you can add a little bit more black shading in there as well. At this point, I'm going to go back to the neutral gray and add some final details, take care of that overspray spot there, and we're getting close to finishing this one up. First thing I want to address is this little overspray oval that I put in to this one using the freehand shield. So using a freehand shield again, I'm going to protect that oval, and then with my gray, I can work on covering this up. that looks better. The other thing I would like to do is clean up these corners that we now have very sharp where I added that shadow. To do that, I'm just going to put a specular highlight on this corner. Ordinarily, I would probably come back in with pure white, an opaque white, to do this. For the sake of time, I'm going to use this neutral gray. Oops, that was a little heavy on both sides. Remember to work in light layers. I'm trying to hurry. And I'm creating some issues for myself by doing so. Work in light layers and dry your paint in between those light layers. The other little detail that I would like to add on these is a small highlight in each one of our little ovals. The holes on dice are normally concave, so it stands to reason some light would reflect off of those holes. Remembering your light source, I'm going to use the freehand shield again to line this up down in the center, and I'm offsetting it slightly. I'm just going to fog a touch of paint in there. I thought I was going to like a little bit of a black sliver around that highlight more than I think I do. So I'm going to line this back up directly over it and do the same thing. Again, less is more. Doesn't take much to do this. Just the edge, and I should be lined up closer to the right, actually. That looks better. See, I'm just barely putting some color right there in the corner. I finished up those highlights off camera just to save some time because this video is turning out way longer than I anticipated it to be. But hopefully you can see what a difference that small little highlight makes. It's not much. I kept the highlight just on the very edge of our oval and then barely brought it in, and it really makes it look like those are actually concave. At this point, I'm pretty happy with what we have. I think we'll go ahead and remove the remainder of the mask and see if there's anything else we need to clean up. That looks pretty good. I'm happy with how this demonstration has gone so far, although it's taken a lot of time. If there are areas that you need to clean up after you've removed the complete mask, you can always come back in with your freehand shield, use that to protect the areas you need to, and then spray your black around the dice in order to clean them up. I did clean up a couple of areas off camera, just due to time constraints, doing exactly that. I also used the oval on the freehand shield to come back in and reinforce the opposite corner of the highlighted portion of all of these little ovals, just to clean those up a little bit and add a little bit more depth to the piece. The last thing we need to talk about are the little wispy lines that kind of portray some movement as well. The easiest way to do that for me would just be to come in freehand and knock those out. I know Steve has not been airbrushing for a really long period of time, so he may not have the confidence to go in and create those quick dagger strokes with using only freehand skills. A really easy way to do that is just to take a piece of paper and your razor blade or your X-Acto knife. I'm going to cut a curved line into a piece of paper. Then we can take our mask and line it up where we want it. I'm going to try to put it right on the corner of that die. And although paper is not easy to see through, I can fold it back and forth to see if I'm even remotely close, and that will probably work. Then taking the airbrush and our neutral gray, I'm just going to spray lightly, letting the air open up that little slit that we cut. And it creates a nice little wispy line. You can use the same mask a couple of different times. To create a similar effect. I did a pretty poor job of lining up those little wisps. They should have been closer to the center so that I would have had room to put some on the left side as well. But overall, I'm happy with how this turned out as far as a demonstration panel goes. It's a relatively simple approach to painting a pair of white dice over a black background using really only two colors. The neutral gray, you could also use a white if you chose to, and the black. If you are using a gray tone, you could also come in with a pure white to really brighten up and make some of the highlights pop. This is very similar to how I would approach doing the same thing. You can add to it from here or subtract some of the things that you don't like. Use it to help yourself improve. That's the whole goal. And the only way that we are going to continue to improve is to practice. So I hope you guys got something out of this. If you did, remember to like, subscribe, and share. As always, I'll leave links to all of the products that I used in this video in the description below. They are affiliate links, so if you choose to make a purchase through one of those links, I do get a very small portion of that sale at no extra cost to you, which helps to support the channel. I greatly appreciate that. I'm Trevor with Wicked Arch Studio. I'll see you guys next time.